Hello and welcome to the 14th episode in our series, The Evolution of a Nation, a documentary series chronicling Uganda's political and economic history. I'm Bart Kakoza. Now, in the previous episode, we saw Amin's invasion of Tanzania and Tanzania's retaliation that resulted into the fall of Amin's regime. We also saw the Moshi Conference that brought together anti-Amin's forces. In this episode, we focus on Lule's 68 days presidency, the Benaisa's umbrella, and the military commission takeover. Thanks for joining us.
Kironde Lule, do solemnly swear.
Shortly after Amin's departure, the UNLF moved to Kampala and Lule was officially sworn in as president. An interim government was established.
We formed the organs in Moshi, and the war moved into Tanzania, into Dar es Salaam. The next thing was, by 11th April, they were here.
The new president was advised by the interim parliament, the National Consultative Council, NCC, which comprised representatives from the Moshi Unity Conference. Driven by what they termed the Moshi spirit, the new government came with full energy and enthusiasm to implement the UNLF principles.
You know, the principles were so national independence, economic development, peace and tranquility, and so on, and national unity. Those were so high flown, like the 1789 French Revolution.
And then the powerful military commission, comprising, among others, Paul Muwanga as chairman, Yoweri Museveni vice chairman, Tito Okello, Oito Jok, and Zed Maruru.
In that period, although we had confusions, but at least there was a sense of recovery from the Amin injuries.
Now, the Lule government was faced with the monumental task of rebuilding the economical and psychologically devastated country. Conflict surfaced immediately between Lule and some of the more radical members of the National Consultative Council, who saw him as too conservative, too autocratic, and not willing to allow council decisions and mandate.
When we started governing, we realized Lule was not respected. In fact, it is, you should put it on record, that the late Oite Ojok, the commander of the army, never in his life called Lule president. He only refers to him as chairman of the UNLF, chairman. And Lule was very annoyed. At one time, Lule called me and he said, "In the Defense Act, can't you delete that the army chief is a member of the Defense Council?" So I said, "You can't do that. You either sack him or he remains as long as he is."
There was also disagreement with the more radical National Consultative Council members, who first of all saw Lule as very conservative and feared he would bring sectarian politics.
Immediately we got to Kampala here, he addressed the nation in Uganda. And I, you know, president of Uganda.
But that's what you wanted. You wanted somebody from
But you see, at least you must hide your teeth.
Secondly, they detected tendencies of his wanting to sideline Tanzania.
Lule came here and he started trying to distance Tanzania from decision making. Started to go to Kenya and all that, and Tanzania was saying, "Look, we are interested in what happened in Uganda because we have put our people there. They have, our people have shed blood. We cannot just leave Uganda to anybody. We didn't have a national army. UNLA was there, but again, the main force was still TPDF. It was the defense forces. Nyerere was not a missionary to come here and just put his troops around and then close his eyes on what is happening. You have your people here, you have and a big number. You must make sure they are protected.
He wanted to replace Tanzanians with other troops, probably get the British to come and replace them. And we said, why? Some of us were already talking about the Republic of Tanzaganda. You know, that we should have a unity, Uganda and Tanzania, and form a federation immediately, one unitary government. But he was looking now to some other people to come in. And we said, no. Where were they when we were fighting Amin, when we were getting rid of Amin? Tanzania helps us. Now you come and say, go. And that wasn't acceptable.
But most importantly, he depicted autocratic signs when he disregarded National Consultative Council's call to respect and adhere to the Moshi Agreement.
First of all, we said, Lule, you cannot appoint people without clearance of NCC. Because we're a coalition. You must bring your list, we discuss it, and we'll embrace it. Lule said, no, I'm a president, I choose anybody. That was really the main issue.
He didn't want to abide by the NCC, the UNLF principles of ratification. Because we were supposed to ratify his choices. Now, he comes with a list. I say, Your Excellency, please table your names. Your names are going to be accepted, except a few of them. There were actually, I think, four of those who were not going to be accepted. One was Gracie Binjara. Gracie Binjara was seen most of the time with Lule, and they seemed to think he was doing the same role as he was doing with Obote, which turned against him again. So that this intriguing should. The other one was Robert Ssemwanga. Robert Ssemwanga, in the short time we were in Kampala, there were stories about four people who had been killed. Bakuru, the Bagonza, Katuramu, and I think one other. Simply because there was some deal, land deal and something, because Bakuru was in land, and Katuramu was a valuer and so on. So these were eliminated purportedly because when he was away, some land transaction had taken place. So, and so we thought, this is not quite good. And then Kaira was actually also quite close to Lule and Robert Ssemwanga. From my assessment, and I discussed it with Lule, these were the four people who would not be ratified. But the others he had chosen, the Kamuntus and whatnot, the Kategayas, all those were going to be ratified. But he refused. So, in direct confrontation,
Lule did not like the National Consultative Council. He said they had no powers, he said he was going to rule by 1967 constitution. But we said where there was conflict, the minutes of Moshi, which had been passed by the NCC, were supreme. He said, no. I disappoint. The NCC has no right.
So Nyerere realized that he had reached a stage where he should let Obote come back. I was in my office as Attorney General when the President Lule called me, said, Tanzania, the government of Tanzania has called us for a consultation for about 2 hours at Mwanza. So please come. We joined the President. Now, to show you that Lule was not very political, when Nyerere called him, he said, I want you to come with the Minister of Justice, with the Minister of Information, with the Minister of Defense, with the Minister. He named the portfolios. But Lule knew that most of those that were named were against him. So Lule announced the hard reshuffle cabinet. He didn't consult us. So I became Minister of Justice and Attorney General. Remember at that time, Nabudere was the Minister of Justice. Ebinjira became the Minister of Information. That time, it was late Ejaru. Ejaru was Minister of Information. Kaira became Minister of Internal Affairs. Paul Mwanga had been the leader of that. There were other shuffles, which ensured that those going, the majority of them, were now pro-Lule. Now, Tanzania was very angry when they heard the reshuffle on the radio. So Nyerere called Lule and said, notwithstanding that reshuffle, you must also bring the ones that I had named who are there, the Nabuderes, the Ejalus, who were previously. So we came as a double when we went there. Nyerere came with the whole cabinet. We came with all the top officials of provincial government and so forth. So he said, we are going to meet tonight. Remember, we are supposed to go for 2 hours. We are going to meet tonight to solve two problems. No, yeah, three problems. One, what has to do with your famous exile, Milton Obote? He's still here, Tanzania asking, why is he still doing here when we liberated Uganda? So we have to decide tonight what he should do. Two, we must decide when you are going to pay our money. At that time, it was 11 million USA dollars for liberating you. Eventually, it became enormous anyway. Three, we must now determine how and what terms the TP force, the Tanzanian People's Force, will stay in Uganda, and who is going to be commanding and so forth. But we shall discuss those. So he stood up and went. At 8 exactly at night, we were driven to State Lodge at Mwanza, and we sat down. After 5 minutes, comes in the President Nyerere, Julius Nyerere, accompanied by who? By Milton Obote. Only two people sat on the platform, Nyerere and Obote. Paul Mwanga, having been dropped as Minister of Internal Affairs, became Minister of Labour. But he appealed to the President. He said, I am a sick man, I am dying. This is what has been happening, Minister. Please give me anything, very little. I will accept it. He was kneeling in the Shiganda way. So at State House, Lule became very, very sympathetic, so he made him Minister of Labour. Now, we traveled with him. So Nyerere said, let's listen to the BBC. These people are operators. He has a transistor radio on the platform. So he switched it on. The only item that came in on that radio, even now I doubt whether it wasn't there. He said, this is the BBC Africa. As we broadcast, there is a crisis in Uganda. The new government set up by Nyerere of Tanzania after liberating Uganda is at each other's throats. They cannot agree. As we speak now, they have traveled to Tanzania, Mwanza, to see whether Nyerere can reconcile with them. See, as you can see, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, there was no lady, gentlemen, we have a problem. There is a crisis. Let's listen to some of you, what you say. You say, anybody speak? Of course, everything is arranged, as I'm going to tell you, yes. As I told you at the caucus. Say, yes, Paul Mwanga. Paul Mwanga said, Mr. President, we have a big problem in Uganda. The government you set up with the comrade Obote and Lule is totally in shambles. Lule has become a dictator. He does not listen to anybody. The advisors we put in the consultative council, he doesn't listen to them, and it is a nightmare. As you may have heard last night, we were chosen by the three of you to be ministers. He has dismissed us. We are no longer ministers. First of all, this is a man who was kneeling to him a few hours ago, my brother, clapping for him, thanking in Uganda. Now he's the biggest tormentor and accuser of him. Next, I take a jab. Ugandans, all of them think you are the savior of our country. And they recognize three presidents as I speak now. You are number one, Obote is number two, and Lule is number three. And they are looking forward very, very much for two of you, Nyerere and Uganda, to come to Uganda. What this man has said is true. President is not as political as you are. So he has failed to appreciate the differences. He's well intentioned, there is no problem about him, and I think we can work together if you can counsel us how we should go forward. Then he said something good. He said, however, Obote is not innocent. I recently got information that he wanted to assassinate me and some of the members of this government, and I was saved in a boat in Chioga. Obote never forgot that. So when he came here, he never gave him anything. When he came back in 1980-81. Now, everybody spoke against him. Then he called those, obviously, who had been told we are pro-Lule. He called Museveni. Museveni was neutral. He spoke very well. He really explained the problems as he saw them, and he said, I advised Lule to listen to the Consultative Council, but he didn't. Instead, he relied on people who were not even members, which was true. However, I believe that also these Paul Mwangas and so forth have been parading the UPC line, and that line was rejected at Moshi. So they are also out of order. But Mr. President, you can really solve these problems, can be solved if we all put our heads together. Then Obote would occasionally bat him. He said, really? Are you saying that the president did that? What kind of decision is that? Really? Are you saying the president ignored the parliament? Oh my God. So that's when I realized for the first time and a few of us that really we were not an independent government of a country, we were a puppet of Tanzania,
yeah.
And we had just come to be told off and to behave ourselves. We were feeling at that time that we were schoolboys who had misbehaved, and the headmaster Nyerere and his deputy headmaster Obote had come to pass judgment. Then he said, it comes to the question of what do we do with Obote? So we had already made a decision that there is no way we can take Obote back. If he has to come back, he must come during elections, but not in 2 years of the NLF government. So Lule said, Mr. President, as you know, this is a coalition of all Ugandan political parties, and all portfolios were decided. No, by Atamoshi. But he said, he can come back. This is what Nyerere, before we discuss, he said, of course, you can take Obote back as just an ordinary person. He's been president. And in fact, in other countries, he should be still president even for his in exile. So you can take him as Minister of Foreign Affairs, or maybe as Vice President. Atemalimeli said, there is no way I can relinquish my portfolio as Minister of Foreign Affairs, because it was agreed, all of us. But you can consider him for anything else. So Obote said, in any case, now Obote talks, I was not going to accept to be Minister of Foreign Affairs. A man who has been president, how can I be Minister of Foreign Affairs? But I might consider being Vice President. Lule said, on this matter, Mr. President, let's cut the discussion short. There is no way we can make a decision here. We shall have to go back and consult our people, consult the Consultative Council, consult other leaders, opinion makers, before we make that decision. That ended. Then Nyerere said, now our money, it is 11 million. When are you going to pay it? So President said, we shall discuss that when we go back, because again, we need your officials, financial experts and ours to meet together, and they calculated this, come up with a report, we shall act on that. He said, that sounds a good idea. He wanted us to go back. He said, let's go back to the issue of Obote. Lule said, Mr. President, I told you must leave here by 4. It's getting to 4. So we must leave now. And we said we are going to consult there. You should have seen their face. They were so angry, shocked.
Both of Obote and
Yeah. Both, yes, both of them. Because they had a design that we would come with Obote as vice president. That was the idea. So we refused. He accompanied us to the airport. Obote didn't come. But he was angry. So when we were going to board, I was in the same plane as the president. And he said, he didn't say Mr. President or Chairman, he said, Lule, I want you to go and consult. By next Saturday, you report to me, not here in Mwanza, but in Dar es Salaam. Now I can tell you that Lule consulted, we all refused, everybody, nobody wanted to. He said, if Obote has to come, he will come through the elections after 2 years. When he went and reported to Nyerere, that's when some of the Gang of Four went there and they passed. Nyerere proposed that if they remove Lule democratically, then he will accept it. Hence, the meeting at the State House, the removal.
We said, this man must go. If he doesn't go, we will be stuck. We're not going to go back on. We don't want this dictatorship. So we moved to Entebbe. We started the debate around 2:30 and did not end until about 1 o'clock in the morning without a break. We said, Mr. President, please. He said, no. Wangola moved a motion of no confidence.
I get a call from the late James Senabulia, who was the personal assistant to Lule, and he said, these people have come here. They called the president. We are sitting in the living room of the State House, and they have produced a piece of paper, and they are debating, as I speak, a vote of no confidence in the chairman. We were not aware of it. So I said, can I speak to the president? He said, they are stopping him going until they break. So I said, you tell him, or write him a note, I consulted the Chief Justice, Wambuzi, that our constitution, the UNLF constitution, prohibits any vote of no confidence during the 2 years. Secondly, it says a meeting of importance, you must give 2 weeks' notice. No notice has been given to anybody. So tell them that that resolution is incompetent and should not be discussed. Oh, I told Senabulia, let the president not attend the meeting. He should go to bed or wherever. He should not be part of that meeting. Unfortunately, he didn't obey me, so he stayed there sitting. But apparently, he never said anything. He called me. So I answered. He said, you must come here immediately. You must come and give us legal advice. These people have ambushed me, and they may pass this vote of no confidence. So the chief just said, you go there, tell them that, let them debate, pass their resolution, but the president cannot be removed by a resolution. We must look at the constitution, and they should bring it to court. Either we accept it or we don't. So I went to the gate. We were, remember, in Nairo Mansions. The gates were manned by Tanzanian forces. They said, no, sir. I said, I am the attorney general. They said, no, we are not allowing you. Our orders said nobody should come in Nairo Mansion or get out. I said, excuse me. The president of this country is the one calling me. Please call the State House. They'll tell you. He said, no, we are not even supposed to call the State House. Afandi, not even God can pass here, according to our instructions.
That was serious.
So I went back. I told the Chief Justice, he said, what can we do? Let's wait and see what they do.
We debate. The vote is taken. Lule is removed. At about 1 o'clock in the morning.
Now, the mistake he made, if perhaps he had walked away and not participated in the debate, he joined the debate, he talked, the people who supported him, I was one of those, saying, please get your ratification, presented. Four people voted for him. I think it was him. It was Busase. I think it was Kaira. And me. Suddenly I was one of them. I voted for him.
So I had to state, Mr. Chairman, I announce as a result of the vote, I regret to announce that you are no longer chairman of UNLF, and therefore it follows that I'm no longer president of Uganda. I found it was very painful. Do you know he listened to us, to me? Could hear a pin drop. He shed a tear, and wiped it, and walked up to the upstairs. So there was confusion.
So at that time, Uganda did not have a president?
No president. So he said, gentlemen, we must have a president. So, can you propose names? Mwanga, Rugumayo, Binaisa. So, Mwanga and me had to withdraw now.
Why? You had to withdraw?
Yeah. I asked Sentebo to now to be the chair. Yeah. They debated for hours. We went to sleep even.
From evening up to morning. So, again, swapping around for an old man who can keep the house together.
They came and tell us, come back to the room. So we came. And Sempewa announces that the new president is Godfrey Lukongo Binaisa. I resume my chair now. About at dawn, who arrives with Binaisa in a Land Rover, Museveni, and Mukombe Mpambara? We have no time. You have now to...
You have to inform the nation.
And you have to appoint your cabinet. Yes. And we're at fight. So, within a couple of hours, we had a new president and a new cabinet. It was not complete, but it was there.
So where was Lule then?
What? Up in that room there. He was still saying he was president. And then, the word spread in Kampala. The whole of Kampala went into confusion.
No work.
Over Fufatufatufe and all those.
We were lucky. We had a UN M7, I can tell you, in the Nair Mansion. Because he organized the when these people had come to invade us, to blow us up. Kaira had organized
a fuel tank.
It had been brought there to be blown up. But when they targeted the RPG, now, you hit it, probably it gushes back to you. So they tried to hit it from a distance, which was beyond the RPG's range, and it blew up in the bay. And then when it had blown up twice, they ran, and they left even some of the others. And it was on my side of the hotel. It's between now Royal and, I was in one of those rooms.
The whole day, we met, we said, no, people have a right to demonstrate. They're angry because we have not explained to them what happened. Binaisa had to be sworn in that afternoon. But Lule was still saying he was president.
Still at State House.
Still at State House. So we went on radio, we explained. Later on, we had a meeting of the elders. We explained what happened. And there was peace.
We heard that Lule had been forced to leave State House and he was now in Tanzania.
In the next episode, we feature the period when Uganda was ruled by three presidents at a time and the immense power and influence of the military commission, the return of Obote, and the controversial 1980 elections. Thanks for watching and see you then. Le, 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 le. Le, 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 le.